are, what you're doing. Your sanctuary is wherever you are. And wherever your sanctuary is, God is also there.
Good morning, Mount Zion family and friends. I'd like to welcome you to our virtual worship experience. The psalmist says, "Lift up your head, O ye gate, and be ye lifted up, and the King of glory shall come in." Who is the King of glory? The Lord, strong and mighty. The Lord, mighty in battle. Let us pray. O most gracious and holy God, Lord, we thank you for this opportunity once again to worship and praise your holy and righteous name. Lord, we need a word from you. So, Lord, we pray a special blessing on the one who will bring the word on this morning. Lord, may you speak through them with clarity, God. May you speak with conviction to our hearts, God. Lord, we need to hear from you. God, your people need to be enlightened. Your people need hope, inspiration, encouragement. So, God, we believe that we will receive that on this morning. So, God, be with us individually and collectively. We invoke the presence of your Holy Spirit right now in this virtual worship experience. This is your servant's prayer. In the matchless name of Jesus, we pray. And all of God's people said, amen. Please prepare your hearts for our sacred scripture.
Good morning. Our sacred scripture reading comes from the book of Proverbs, chapter 24 and verse 17, the Good News Translation, and it reads this way. Don't be glad when your enemies meet disaster, and don't rejoice when they stumble. This is God's holy and inerrant word. Please give your attention to the sacred hymn of the morning.
Hallelujah. God bless you, brothers and sisters. And thank you so much for joining us for this virtual worship experience today. Won't you take a moment and bow with me in prayer? Eternal God, thank you so much for the privilege and opportunity of sharing your word today. I pray that your people will be blessed and that you will be pleased. It's in the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. Today, our verse of focus is found in Proverbs 24:17. And I'm going to be using the Good News Translation today throughout the message. And in Proverbs chapter 24, verse 17, it says, "Don't be glad when your enemies meet disaster, and don't rejoice when they stumble." I want to talk today about how to treat your enemy. How to treat your enemy. Now, before I can get deep into this message, I'll have to share a disclaimer with you. In light of current events of this nation, and you know what we're going through, the Holy Spirit has compelled me to share this message with you today. If this message reminds you of yourself or someone you know, it's strictly coincidental. I promise you, it's not intentional. Now, before we can go deep into this passage, we first have to ask a couple of questions. The first question I'll need to ask is this, and you'll need to ask, what is an enemy? What is an enemy? Well, by definition, an enemy is one that is antagonistic to another, especially one seeking to injure, overthrow, or confound an opponent. That's the definition. According to Merriam-Webster, that's the definition of an enemy. Now think about this for a moment. Most people know somebody they consider to be an enemy. But then again, if you know one, you probably know more than one. Enemies are people who are negative towards you and relish in actively working against you. And not only do they work against you, but they work against anything or anybody you are for or with. Now, I gotta admit, it's important for you to identify your enemies. And once you've identified them, it's important to keep your eyes on them. Oh yeah, I'm not saying lose any sleep over them, but you need to keep your eyes on them. And the reason you do this is because not to keep your eyes on them is a grave mistake. Enemies are dangerous. Don't let anybody fool you. Even enemies who wear collars and enemies who work in church, they're dangerous people. Now, you may be able to transform some of your enemies into allies. But for the most part, that's not gonna happen very often. That's because enemies just don't like you. Now, let's talk about these enemies a little deeper. Your enemies are easily identified because they talk negatively about you with the intent of destroying you. That's what they want to do. Does that mean you've done anything wrong to them? They generally don't want you to have what you have, or sometimes they want what you have. Most of the time, they don't want it. They just don't want you to have it. They want you to be miserable. They want you to be hurt. They want you to be harmed. Enemies are overly critical of any good thing that you do. And they'll outright condemn you if you make a mistake. I mean, they'll go in on you like you're the only one that's ever done something. When many times they've done it themselves, but they'll go in on you. They can't stand for you to succeed at anything. And they will say or do anything to destroy your success. Anything you're a part of, they'll rip apart because they don't want it to succeed because of your connection. Now be careful. While criticism may be a marker of enemies, not all criticism comes from your enemies, and not all criticism is destructive or intended to hurt you. There are people who love you that will criticize you, and it will sting, but their goal is not to hurt or harm you. It's to help you. And you have to know how to distinguish between the two. Now, your enemies want to bring you down, and they'll stop at nothing to reach their goal. If one trick and trap doesn't work, they'll go another way. Often they'll even attack the people that love and support you. Now, not all people fall into the class of an enemy or friend. You know, some people think if they're not my friend, they're my enemy. If they're my enemy, they're not my friend. There's more than one class of more than two classes of people. There's another class. Some people occupy the unique class called acquaintances. Now, an acquaintance is someone you know a little about, but they're not necessarily your friend. An acquaintance is far less intimate than a friend. Like a person in your class whose name you know, or a person you work with but have little to no interaction. An enemy is generally hostile towards you, but some have mastered the art of fakery, and they can play roles better than the best award-winning performers in Hollywood. But you know they're an enemy, and you know it because of how they treat you, and coupled with the fact that they've hurt you in the past, or they keep trying to harm you at every opportunity, and even go so far as to conjure up opportunities to help you. Now, here's the second thing. Second question I want to look at. Who is your enemy? Who is your enemy? Now, most of us have a predisposition to associate an enemy with those who hate us or oppose us. But I've discovered that someone can dislike you or even hate you and not be your enemy. Yep. Now, I know that may sound a little strange, but that's because some people don't really hate you. They don't like you. And because they don't like you, they elect not to be bothered with you. They're not trying to destroy you, not trying to harm you, not trying to hurt you. They just leave you alone. They don't talk about you behind your back. In fact, they don't even think about you. You're not on their mind. You're not in their thoughts. They're just, I guess you could say, indifferent towards you. People like this really aren't your enemy, but you often brand them as your enemy and subsequently end up creating an enemy. See, we don't necessarily control who is our enemy, but we can control who we see as an enemy. Your enemy is one of the foulest kind of people to be around because they burn with a craving to get revenge. To get revenge for what you've done or what they think you've done or what they heard you done or just cause. So they bring your name up and then they put their mouth on you in any setting or situation. And Lord, don't let somebody say something nice about you. They will kill your name, your children, and everything good that you've ever done. And to make things worse, they don't care about the fact that guiltless spectators become their collateral damage. Your enemies don't even care about who gets hurt. Their mission is to destroy you. And by any means necessary, they will lie to you or anyone in your world and not care about whose reputation or what relationship they ruin in the process. They'll ruin a relationship with their own friends just to get to you. They want what some call and consider sweet revenge, not knowing that there's no such thing as sweet revenge. Revenge destroys the good in a person and poisons their soul. The third and final question I have to ask before we get into the text is, what does the Bible command of us regarding our enemy? What does the Bible command of us regarding our enemy? Well, at the time of the writing of this text, it was customary. It was customary to extend hospitality to travelers, whether you knew them or not. I mean, there was no Motel 6 or Holiday Inn. Travelers would stay in the homes of people. Sometimes hospitality meant allowing total strangers to stay in your home. That's something that wouldn't be happening today. But it was God who called his people to show hospitality to their enemies. That was not the custom of the day. God called his people to do that. He called them to show hospitality to the ones who had hurt them and failed to repent. Because that's what a real enemy is. somebody who's hurt you and failed to repent. Here's what we're to do, what we're commanded by the Bible to do regarding our enemies in a nutshell. It's in Luke chapter 6, verses 27 through 36. Listen at what the verses say. But I tell you who hear me, love your enemies, do good to those who hate you, bless those who curse you, and pray for those who mistreat you. If anyone hits you on one cheek, let him hit the other one too. If someone takes your coat, let him have your shirt as well. Give to everyone who asks for something, and when someone takes what is yours, do not ask for it back. Do for others just what you want them to do for you. If you love only people who love you, why should you receive a blessing? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good only to those who do good to you, why should you receive a blessing? Even sinners do that. And if you lend only to those from whom you hope to get it back, why should you receive a blessing? Even sinners lend to sinners to get back the same amount. No, love your enemies and do good to them. Lend and expect nothing back. You will then have a great reward, and you will be children of the Most High God. For he is good to the ungrateful and the wicked. Be merciful, just as your Father is merciful. Brothers and sisters, it's clear. The Bible commands us to be merciful. We are to be merciful toward our enemies. Why? Because being merciful is one of the keys to your happiness. You don't believe it? Take a look at what Matthew says in chapter 5, verse 7. He says, happy are those who are merciful to others. God will be merciful to them. Now I know you're used to hearing blessed are, but that's what it means. Happy. To be merciful is to show mercy. See, mercy is compassion or leniency. As God's people, I think we sometimes forget. But really, we don't forget. We often ignore how we are commanded to treat the people who oppose us. I know they can make our lives miserable, but we're not entitled to treat them as they have treated us. I'd like to offer this sermon today as a friendly reminder to every believer. God has called us to a much higher standard. And in our text, we are informed as to how we're to treat our enemies. Here in Proverbs 24:17, it says, don't be glad when your enemies meet disaster, and don't rejoice when they stumble. When you read this passage, to say that our response toward our enemy should be one of graciousness is an understatement. More appropriately, mercy suits this case. Now, don't think for one minute that any of us have obtained the rank of the world's most merciful individual. Every last one of us is a work in progress. Not only are we a work in progress, there are times when we all need the very same mercy extended towards us. So what am I saying? I'm saying none of us are so spiritually mature to the point that we don't make mistakes. We don't sometimes mistreat others, even when we're unaware of it, and stand in need for others to be merciful towards us. We're still growing. Don't forget that. Now, let me give you these three topical considerations, and then I'm going to be done. How to treat your enemy. Number one, don't celebrate. Don't celebrate. Listen at the verse. Don't be glad when your enemies meet disaster. Don't celebrate. When bad things happen to your enemy, don't celebrate. Ladies and gentlemen, listen. We cannot afford to take the risk of celebrating the downfall and the disaster of our enemy because it happens to us. We all fall down. Listen, the reason we cannot afford to celebrate the disaster of our enemy is because of what Romans 3 and 23 says. It says, everyone has sinned and is far away from God's saving presence. Listen, being an enemy is sinful. And we've all done something sinful. So you can't celebrate somebody else's, even your enemy's, downfall. What does Micah say in Micah 7 and 8? He says, our enemies have no reason to gloat over us. We have fallen, but we will rise again. We are in darkness now, but the Lord will give us light. Listen, we have fallen, all of us. So we can't afford to celebrate over the downfall of somebody else. We have fallen. And we get up, but our enemies get up too. Then take a look at Psalm 145:14. Listen at what it says. He helps those who are in trouble. He lifts those who have fallen. Now listen, I've seen God lift enemies. I've seen them go down, come back up. We do not control the mercy of God. And because we don't, we cannot celebrate when something happens, when calamity and disaster overtake our enemies. Here's the second thing. When dealing with your enemies, how do you treat them? Remember now, don't celebrate. But here's the second thing. Don't combat. Don't fight. I know this is not easy, but I got news for you. In case nobody told you, it's a waste of time. It's a waste of time because, first of all, we usually combat or fight the wrong thing. Take a look at Ephesians 6 and 12, and this is what it says. For we are not fighting against human beings, but against the wicked spiritual forces in the heavenly world, the rulers, authorities, and cosmic powers of this dark age. Listen, brothers and sisters, this is saying we're not fighting people. We are fighting forces, spirits. Now, secondly, we don't do combat, remember, because we fight the wrong thing. But secondly, we employ the wrong weapons. Listen what Isaiah 54:17 has to say. Isaiah 54:17 says, but no weapon will be able to hurt you. You will have an answer for all who accuse you. I will defend my servants and give them victory. These are the errors of our ways that will ensure that we lose our battle if we dare try to combat our enemies. Here's what we must never forget when feeling like we want to pick a fight, when we feel like we want to go into combat with our enemies. Remember in 2 Chronicles 20:15, it says, the battle depends on God, not on you. Whew. Don't forget that. It's not yours. It's the Lord's. I wish I had Yolanda Adams right here with me right now to jump in here and sing that. But it's not yours. It's the Lord's. And then remember Romans 12:19. Never take revenge, my friends, but instead let God's anger do it. For the scripture says, I will take revenge. I will pay back, says the Lord. Let me tell you what I've discovered. Last thing you want to do is try to do God's job. You can't even do what he assigned you to do. So how in the world do you think for one moment that you can do God's job? Here's the last passage I want you to take a look at, and then I'm going to get out of this one. Deuteronomy 28:7 says, the Lord will defeat your enemies when they attack you. They will attack from one direction, but they will run from you in all directions. Did you hear that assurance that we have? So don't you go picking a fight. But if they pick the fight with you, they better be ready, because they would be better off grabbing two tigers by the tail and tying them in the knots. Because God is going to do his perfect work. And the next thing you know, they'll be running in every direction. Remember now, how do you treat your enemies? This is how to treat your enemies. Number one, don't celebrate. Number two, don't combat. Number three, don't crucify. Yep, don't crucify. No matter who you are, there will come a time when someone will hurt you. Sometimes it's a stranger. Sometimes it's a so-called friend. And unfortunately, sometimes it can even be your family. Now, don't forget this. Just because they hurt you doesn't mean they are your enemy. But if you make them your enemy, or they become your enemy, you cannot crucify them. And you can't crucify them because God's mercy is extended even towards our enemy. Think about it. When our Lord the Christ was on the cross, at no point, he could have, but he didn't, at no point did he try to hurt or harm his enemies. This is our motto, brothers and sisters. In fact, he never even said a bad thing about his enemies. He wasn't talking them down and beating them up. He didn't even wish anything bad on them. And he certainly didn't pray anything bad on them. He could have called down legions of angels, but he didn't. But I'll tell you what he did do for them. He prayed for them. Now, I know you don't like that because you don't want to pray for your enemies. But he prayed for them. And that's what we have to learn to do. Don't crucify him. Pray for them. Listen to what Peter said in 1 Peter 2 and 23. When he was insulted, he did not answer back with an insult. When he suffered, he did not threaten, but placed his hopes in God, the righteous judge. This is our role model, brothers and sisters. We are not to crucify, to kill, physically, emotionally, or spiritually. We are to pray for our enemies and rest our hope in God. Here's what many of us don't realize. Every one of our enemies come with an expiration date. Whatever they do and them, they may last, but it's not endless. Whatever they do is going to come to an end, and so will they. We have to stop thinking about the wrong that people do to us, because if you don't, thinking about it will cause you to become bitter. And bitterness will generate evil thoughts. So to combat evil thoughts, we have to substitute our thoughts of wrong, and we have to take Paul's recommendation in Philippians 4 and 8. He says, in conclusion, my friends, fill your minds with those things that are good and that deserve praise. Things that are true, noble, right, pure, lovely, and honorable. In Proverbs 24, and 17, I just love Solomon's sage advice, which in reality is God's guidance. He says, again, don't be glad when your enemies meet disaster, and don't rejoice when they stumble. This verse is saying, don't be glad they experience disaster, pain, calamity, and fall or stumble. Why? Because when you do, you're openly revealing the kind of heart you possess. If you keep reading Proverbs 24 and go down into verse 18, you'll rapidly discover why we're given this advice. Look at verse 18. The Lord will know if you are gloating, and he will not like it. And then maybe he won't punish them. Did you hear that? He won't like it, and then maybe he won't punish them. The Lord will know not people, the Lord. The Lord will know, because the Lord knows everything. He will know the bitterness in your heart, and he'll know your desire to get revenge. And because he doesn't like it, he'll adjust his punishment strategy. This is vital for the modern believer to remember, because America has become a culture of revenge. We want to get back everybody for what they've done. Listen, the culture of revenge is not just in the White House, it's in your house. And whether you like it or not, believe it or not, it's in the church house. And when God knows our bitterness, he's subject to turn things around for our enemy. This is because God has a history of turning things around. Nobody can turn the tables like my God. Ask Joseph, and he'll tell you in Genesis chapter 50, what my brothers meant for evil, God meant it for good. That's not enough for you. Ask Paul, and Paul will tell you in Romans, all things work together for good. That's not enough. Ask the dead little girl, and she'll tell you, he'll turn a funeral into a party. He just knows how to turn things around. Here's my last witness. Ask Jesus. He'll tell you God will turn a crucifixion into a resurrection. He'll turn it around, I tell you. He knows how to turn it around. And he'll not just turn it around for you. He'll turn it around for your enemies. What you meant for evil, God will turn it around and make it good. How to treat your enemies.
Amen. We thank God for his blessed word today. Indeed, weren't we blessed? And we pray that you will stay with us for a very important part of this worship service, and that is the invitation to discipleship. If you are unsaved, this is an opportunity for you to accept Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. Brothers and sisters, God allowed his only begotten Son to die that we might have eternal life. My friend, you do not want to live in this world without Jesus Christ. It is absolutely essential that you accept Jesus as your Savior right now, today. You can do that wherever you are. The Bible says in Romans chapter 10, verses 9 through 10 in the New International Version, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. For it is with your heart that you believe and are justified, and it is with your mouth that you profess your faith and are saved. If you are not saved and would like to be saved, all you have to do is pray this prayer with me right now. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you admitting that we are sinners. Right now, we choose to turn away from sin, and we ask you to cleanse us with your blood of all unrighteousness. We believe that your Son, Jesus Christ, died on the cross to take away our sin. And we believe that he rose again from the dead so that we might be justified and made righteous through faith in him. And so we call on the name of the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We choose to follow you, and we ask that you will fill us with the power of your Holy Spirit. And we declare right now that we are born again children of God. We are free from sin and full of the righteousness of God. We are saved in Jesus' name. It is in Jesus' name we pray. If you prayed that prayer with me, brothers and sisters, please be assured that you are saved. If you prayed that prayer with me, please give us a call at 703-979-7411. Or you can send us an email at info@mountzionbaptist.com. We would love to hear from you so that we can welcome you into the body of Jesus Christ. Once again, that number is 703-979-7411, or you can email us at info@mountzionbaptist.com. When you contact us, we will direct you to someone who will assist you with whatever questions that you may have about this wonderful gift of salvation. And they will also answer any questions that you may have about joining us at Mount Zion. If you are saved and presently without a church home, and are interested in joining us here at Mount Zion, please give us a call at 703-979-7411 or send us an email at info@mountzionbaptist.com. And we would be more than glad to walk you through the process to become a member of the Mount Zion Baptist Church family. Amen. God bless you. God bless you. It's offering time. And at Mount Zion, if there's any time that we get excited, it's at offering time. We get excited because we know that the Lord loves a cheerful giver. We know that due to our inability to gather, we can't do offering the traditional way. But we invite you to take advantage of the opportunity to give. There are four ways to give to Mount Zion. First, you may give via the Easy Tithe app on your smart device or cell phone. You can easily download the app to your smart device to give. Second, you may also text to give via the Easy Tithe app by dialing 703-372-9244. Again, you may text your offering to 703-372-9244. Thirdly, you may also give by visiting our website, mountzionbaptist.com, and click on online giving and then click on the Easy Tithe app. That website once again is mountzionbaptist.com. Click on online giving and then click on the Easy Tithe logo to give online. And then lastly, you may give by mailing your offering to the address that appears on your screen. Once again, you can mail it to us at that address that appears on your screen. Please know that any way you bless us, we will be satisfied. Thank you so much for your willingness to give. Remember, although we're unable to meet, ministry work still goes on. The ministry continues. The need for your support continues. God bless you, and we thank you so much for your support. Let us pray over the offering. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for your continued blessings. We thank you, God, for how you've continued to watch over us. We pray, God, that the money that is collected today will be used for the upbuilding of your kingdom, Father. We pray, God, that you would give those who are entrusted with the authority to handle it, would do so with wisdom and guidance of your Holy Spirit. These things we ask for and say thank you for in the name of your darling son, Jesus Christ. Amen. May God bless each and every one of you. And we thank you for your generosity and for your kindness. May God bless you richly. Amen.
Good morning, Mount Zion family and friends. It is my pleasure to welcome you to our worship experience on this morning. We thank you for visiting us here at Mount Zion for our virtual worship experience. We are thrilled and super excited that you made Mount Zion your choice for worship on today. It is our hope that something has been said or done and that it will inspire you and carry you throughout the week. If you're without a church home, we invite you to consider Mount Zion, the growing church where everybody is special, for we are a kingdom-focused church. If you wish to learn additional information about our fellowship, please visit our website at mountzionbaptist.com. We also invite you to connect with us on the following social media platforms: Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, and YouTube. Be sure to follow, like, and share us on these social media platforms as well. God bless you. And our thought for the week: you're not stuck at home, you're safe at home. One word can change your attitude, and one cough can change your life. May God bless. Greetings. It is a very special day in the life of our fellowship, Mount Zion, for a very special person. It is the birthday of our beloved bishop, our pastor, our shepherd, our overseer, and the angel of the house, Dr. Leonard N. Smith. Pastor, I'm not sure if I'm able to articulate just how excited we are that it is your birthday. So I've invited some of our members to send a shout out to you on this, your special day. Take a listen.
Greetings, Pastor. Marcus J. Davis is my name. I'm greeting you with a birthday shout out, birthday wish. Happy birthday to you, sir, on this, your special day. We, members at Mount Zion, we love you and we are praying for you. Happy birthday.
Happy birthday, Bishop. I hope you have a blessed day, and I cannot wait to see what the Lord has planned for your future. Love you lots.
Just wanted to do a very quick birthday shout out to the world's best bishop. We love you so much, and we hope that you enjoy your day. And we want to thank you for everything that you've done for us and everything that you will do. Love you. Mwah.
Hello, we're the Kroon family, Elliot, Shannon, and Dashiell.
Pastor Smith, we'd like to wish you a very blessed and happy birthday. We pray that you're staying safe and thriving, even during these difficult times. And we wish you many more years of health and happiness.
Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday, dear pastor. Happy birthday to you.
Good morning, Mount Zion family and friends. We're the Kroon family, and we'd like to invite you to worship with us on Sundays at 10 a.m. There are three ways to worship with us: by visiting www.mountzionbaptist.com and clicking on online streaming, by visiting our Facebook page and clicking on the YouTube link, and by calling 844-506-1020 to listen to the service by telephone.
We also would like to invite you to our virtual Thursday night Bible study at 7 p.m., virtual We Church on Sundays at 12 noon for children, and Sundays at 1 p.m. for virtual Habits Bible study for teens. All are welcome, and we'd love to see you there.
And now, let us prepare our hearts for our sacred departure. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you, God, for what our ears have heard. We thank you, God, for what our hearts have felt. We thank you, God, for just allowing us this opportunity for this worship experience. We pray, God, that everything that we said and did was pleasing in your sight. We pray, God, that you would watch over all of those who viewed and all of those who would have liked to have viewed. We pray, God, that you continue to watch over our pastor, strengthen him, guide him, Father. We pray, God, that you would just bless God's people during these tumultuous and crazy times. And now may the grace of God and the love of Jesus Christ and the sweet communion of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide with you now, henceforth, and forever. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, amen. And now, beloved, go in peace. God bless you.
Make some noise, everybody. Come on, let's rock.